So any questions from the previous classes? Yeah, I haven't sent the document. I'll send it. I have to update few things and send it.
Yes, Santosh, I was just looking at this Groovy syntax, like on the same page. You see where you write this Groovy, like under pipeline option, you see there's a pipeline syntax thing, right?
Right.
And I was looking at that, and I was like, it even giving you the option to give like a Windows batch script also. So,
Yes.
even you can use this batch script
Yeah,
as
we can use
an.
that as well.
Okay, so instead of using the Groovy sandbox, we can use the Windows batch as file as long as you write it down correctly, right?
Yeah, so whichever you are comfortable,
Okay.
you can use that. But mostly what people use is Groovy.
Okay. Any other documents like Groovy, like a syntax or examples, any
I mean, I don't have. So thing is, I think you can Google it for the Groovy.
Okay,
Tutorial
sure.
points and all will be available.
Makes sense. Okay.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you can do salt kick me today for 5 minutes and
Let me see. Actually, I have salt document. Okay, I'll just remind me at the end of the class. I'll search and
sure.
get the
Okay,
document.
perfect. Sure.
Okay. First, we'll start with Dockers today. Another important concept.
Okay.
So, previously, before 20 years or sometime, I mean, a little bit of history, why Dockers concept is introduced, what is the use case, right? So before we start into going through them. So basically, earlier we used to have, let us say, the hardware, right, on top of that operating system, right? So on top of that application used to run. So this was before 20 years or so. We used to have only one operating system running on top of one single machine, and one application was running on it. And then, because of this, there was, under usage of CPU and the memory, right? Because only one application was running, and not even 20% of the CPU or the memory was used, right? So then, so there was an innovation, like people started thinking, like, why can't we run a different application? Why can't we deploy multiple applications on a single machine, right? So how to do that? And so then VMware has come up with the concept of virtualization. So on top of hardware, so they have created a software. This is nothing but hypervisor. So this hypervisor is actually the virtualization software. What it does, it emulates the hardware. It virtualizes the hardware to create multiple independent workstations. So on top of one single box, we can run multiple operating systems. So let us say this is Linux, or this is Red Hat, let us say, and one is Ubuntu, and one is Windows. So we can have multiple operating systems running, and on top of them we can have applications running. App 1, App 2, right? So these are the applications which are running on top of the physical machines. So here the CPU or the memory is effectively utilized, right? So here there is again a problem. So this approach is far better compared to the first approach, but every time we need to install the OS on top of the hardware, on top of the operating virtual machines. So these are nothing but the virtual machines. Right? So then we need to install operating system on virtual machines. Then on top of that, we install the applications. Right here, memory and the CPU resources are utilized properly. But this is a kind of overhead, right? So you need or you don't need, you need to have all the file system and all the packages installed on the machine, right? So then why to install operating system every time? Can't we virtualize the operating system as well, right? So when I say what operating system here, we have the kernel, the utilities, shell, and everything comes here, right? This is the operating system layer. Then the next level of innovation is we have hardware. On top of that, we have operating system. And on top of that, instead of virtualizing the hardware, they virtualized the operating system itself. So then they have created something called containers, container one, container two. And in containers, the application runs. So here, there is a layer called Docker engine. That does the virtualization, that is responsible for sharing the resources between the different containers. So the difference only here is the operating system. We don't have to install operating system every time in containers. Operating system, in the sense the kernel is actually shared between the different containers, right? So what is the difference in this approach and this approach? This is a VM, the Docker container.
In Docker container, there is no VM. It's just containers.
There is no VM. Containers, right? Here, one operating system is there. Here, multiple operating systems are there. Here, hypervisor is used. Here, Docker engine is used, right? So the examples of hypervisor, VMware, ESX, then IBM PowerVM, KVM, kernel-based virtual machine, or Oracle, VirtualBox,
Microsoft
Server, etc. So these are the different hypervisors, right?
This Docker, the OS, the base OS, has to be Linux, right?
It can be anything. On Windows also you can install.
Okay, but like most of the people using Linux, right?
Yeah, most of the people use Linux, but it's supported on Windows as well.
Okay, so let's say you have Linux Red Hat and then you have Docker install, and on top of Docker you have containers where you can run applications, like applications from Windows or Linux, right?
Right.
Okay. But that is the old concept, right?
Yeah, this is actually the old concept. Actually, there was something called WPAR from IBM. Workload Partitions. Okay. So they have introduced this concept some 10 years back. But somehow, it was presented here is different. The use case which IBM presented was different, and the use case which Docker presented is different, right? So actually the main use case for using Docker is something like this, right? So let us say I'm a developer, and so I have developed a feature and then I have deployed it to production. I sent it to the customer and customer deployed in the production, and there is a issue, there is a bug opened, and the bug is something like the application, it's not deployed successfully, it is failing because of one dependency or one library or one binary is missing. So developer says everything is working in his machine, and in the production it is not working, something is missing. So where is the problem? So after RCA, the root cause analysis, it was found like one of the library or binaries missing in the production machine, whereas it is available in the local machine or the laptop of the developer, right? So to avoid this kind of problems, what we can do is, So basically we can combine everything, bundle all the binaries, libraries with the fix, and then send it to the production so that there is no issue, something like something is missing, binary is missing, library is missing, RPM is missing. So everything we are bundling and giving it to the customer, to the production. So this is nothing but image, right? So just to solve the issues of something is missing. So now if we give everything in a bundle and give it to the customer, he can directly deploy it. So there is no problem of something is missing, right? So that image is called Docker image, right? And another use case is something like, let us say I want to just understand, like there is a
so instead of installing the application again in production, you basically ship all the binaries in a bundle, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, maybe this Docker thing is old. I think most of people are switching back to Docker because it's open source and free, right? And instead of paying a lot of license fees to VMware or other hypervisors, I think that is one of the main reasons. Beside that, when you have multiple containers on the same hardware, how smart is it Docker to manage the resource?
Yeah, there are a lot of other tools available to manage, right? We'll discuss.
Okay.
So just understand that there are two ships in water. Okay. So there are big containers which contain something, some goods, and these containers have to be transferred from ship 1 to ship 2. So how do we transfer? So there is something like a Docker where they keep all these containers on the Docker, and it transports these containers to this ship. Okay, so this is ship 1, this is ship 2, this is a Docker which will basically transport the containers from ship 1 to ship 2. So if you replace the same analogy with a machine, this is machine 1 and this is machine 2, right? So, and I want to transfer application from a binary or image from machine 1 to machine 2. How do we transfer? So what we do is we upload the image to Docker cloud from machine 1, and then from here we transfer the image to machine 2, right? So this is actually the Docker concept. This is the main use case. So basically we are transferring an image from one machine to other machine, and for that we use something called Docker. Docker is kind of a transporter which transfers a image from machine 1 to machine 2. That is the main use case. So basically one image contains all the fixes, the features, the binaries, libraries, everything required for the application to deploy successfully, that we give transfer from one machine to other machine. For that we use Docker. So Docker has a cloud, Docker cloud, and this is a repository of images. Like how we did Vagrant cloud, we pull the image from the Vagrant cloud, and then we say when we bring up the machine with the image, with the same image, it will come up, right? So it is actually a pre-installed image. Everything is already done. We just need to bring the machine up with that particular image. In the same way, Docker cloud also has a lot of images. We can just pull the image and get the container up, right? So what is the difference between a virtual machine versus a container, right? So something like virtual machine, let us say you install a virtual machine from ISO, and ISO has a lot of packages. It has NFS utilities and it has all the packages which are required for the virtual machine, right? But container has only things whichever is required for that application to run. Virtual machine has everything even though you don't need it, everything is available in the virtual machine, whereas container has limited set of file sets which are required for the application to run. So something like a independent house versus a flat, right? When you have independent house, you need or you don't need, everything is dedicated to you, right? The resources, whereas flat, most of the things we share with the neighbors, right? So we have only the things whichever is required for living. So that is the analogy between the virtual machine and container. Virtual machine has everything. Everything is dedicated. We have a separate kernel for each virtual machine. All the applications, utilities, everything is dedicated for a single virtual machine. Whereas for container, most of the resources it shares with the other containers. So that's the difference between a virtual machine and container. Container, we can say it as a lightweight virtual machine which shares most of the resources with the other containers. It internally uses something called Linux C groups, namespace isolation. This is for isolating the resources between the different containers. Right? Is this clear?
Yeah. One more thing. For example, if you ship the binaries and you have a base OS, let's say Red Hat, and you ship the binaries to production, right? And in the production, do we have to Red Hat OS as a base there as well, or it can be any?
It can be any. It runs on anything.
Okay. So there's no dependency on the base OS. The container is like fully isolated from the base container, right? From the base OS.
Yes.
Okay. So any example using Docker Cloud, because it looks like it's more of the dev environment. Is it like people using for production also?
People using for production, they have the containers, they have the cluster of containers, they have Docker Swarm and all. They are using for production as well, for deploying the microservices.
Okay. Is Amazon is using Docker Cloud or no? Docker-based cloud?
Using. See, something like this, how the conventional the programming way is something like we deploy everything in a monolithic way, right? You write down the code, everything in a single file or a single architecture.
Okay.
But the new trend is to write the program in microservices. Something like, let us say we have Amazon, right? So Amazon has a lot of features, right? So when you log into Amazon, it shows the recommendations based on the search history, right? And when you log into Amazon, we can pay the bill, let us say, and there is a something called shipping cart, right? So there are different features, but in previously, how do we used to write? Everything used to be in one single file, main file, and we used to call everything, right? So if there is a new function, we add it to the main file and we call it. But here, everything is independent. For recommendations, there is a separate team, they works on it. For billing, there is a separate team. For something else, there is a separate team, right? So this is called a single microservice. By dividing the application into different pieces, it will be really useful to manage, right? So the team, the other team is not dependent on this team. They work independently. They manage the application independently. They fix the issues independently, and everything runs as a single microservice, right? So this microservice runs on a container.
Okay.
So they manage the containers. They can scale up, scale down based on the requirement, and the high availability is also achieved by creating the cluster of containers. Right, if some container goes down, automatically the other container comes up, and if the web traffic goes high, we can also configure in such a way that the containers can scale up. So these are the advantages we get using the containers, right? So using the Dockers. So second thing is something like, let us say I want to execute a Python program, right? So now in a conventional way, what do? We install operating system on the VM, and VM has Python, and we execute a Python program, right? So I only need Python, but when you install VM, you get everything, all the packages, bundles, RPMs, binaries, everything we get. But when we say container, container will only have the Python environment. Whatever is required for the Python to be executed, only those file sets, the bare minimum file sets, will be present in the container, right? Let us say if you want Jenkins container, you just pull the container from Docker Cloud. It will have only the things which are required for the Jenkins to run. For example, Java. Okay. Is this clear?
Yeah, let's say for the Jenkins container, in the container, I still don't understand, because the Jenkins, let's say, for example, Jenkins has a lot of dependencies, like, let's say, Python, all those things. Are we going to install all those dependencies in the container as well?
Generally, the container comes with all the dependencies, but if it doesn't have, then we may need to install.
Oh, so the containers are by default. So they are by default containers that come with the dependencies already? Okay.
They come by default with the dependencies. And the concept here is container is not like a VM where we log in and perform something. It's like a, VM, but nobody logs into it. It's only accessible using the web URL, right? Okay. So you have a container up and running. We simply log into the container, perform the jobs, and connect to the container, request the service, and get the service, and that's all. We don't log into the container, something like Jenkins or any web application or Apache or Tomcat or anything, right? So if it is a Linux container, maybe we can log in. But in general, for containers like Jenkins or containers like Apache, Tomcat, we don't have to log in. Simply we connect and perform the job.
Okay, what I'm trying to understand, let's say you have the Windows base OS and then you have a Jenkins container, but the Jenkins has a lot of dependencies from a Linux operating system. How it can be covered all those dependencies? That's a little bit confusing.
So to understand that, we need to understand first how to make an image, how to run a container out of the image, and what are the things we need to take care while creating the image, right? So somebody has to create a Jenkins image, right? So that we download from the Docker Cloud. So while creating the image itself, we need to take care of all the dependencies. What all the packages it has to install to make Jenkins up and running. So that's what we do when we create image.
Start doing it, then maybe.
Yeah. So let us say Docker Engine is the software that is responsible for virtualization or creating the containers, right? So how do we install this on top of a Linux or a Windows machine? So first we need to install Docker Engine, then we can use Docker to create the containers. So let us take a VM. On top of VM also we can install Docker, right? So let us go to
Docker Engine is a different thing than the container, right?
Different. Docker Engine is a software that runs on top of the operating system. Container is kind of a process, VM, which using Docker Engine we create it. So Docker also has two versions. One is the commercial, the other is the open source. So these are the repositories, and we'll go through them later. For now, let us install Docker. initial install Docker. Then once it is installed, we can use Docker command. Okay, this will provide the helper and the version of the Docker installed. Then the next step is we need to create a container. To create a container, we need to have the image, same like Vagrant. So Docker pull, let us say Ubuntu. This will download the image from Docker Cloud. And when we say Docker images, the downloaded image will be list of images present. Okay, then when we say Docker run the image, it will create a container out of the image. Creates container out of the image. So there are a lot of options which we can run with this Docker run Ubuntu latest, means it will run the latest, it will download the latest Ubuntu image. So first we can do Docker pull, or we can directly do Docker run. If the image is available locally, it will create a container out of it. If image is not available, it will download and install the image from the Docker hub. Then it will create a container out of the Docker image, right? So there is a difference between image and a container, right? Same a Vagrant image and a VM. So container is a process running from the image. Image is like a bundle of software, right? So Docker images will give the list of images present on the machine. Docker PS will give running containers on the machine, right? Then we can use other commands like Docker start stop to stop the container, Docker attach and detach to connect to a container. Okay. Docker RMI, and the every image will have an image ID. This is to remove the image.
Hey, Santosh, normally the Docker containers, they are built by developers, or by who do that job, like building the containers? Or is it done by developers by themselves, or somebody else in the organization do that for them?
So generally developers also do, but basically when we design the entire workflow, so it's all automated, so it's all DevOps process done by DevOps engineers.
Okay.
So we download the Docker image, we get it running, we create the container using Docker run. Docker run is to create a container out of the image. Docker pull is to pull the image, right? And we can also give the version of the Docker image which you want to pull. Here, Docker pull Ubuntu colon and some version. Latest means it will download the latest one. Or Ubuntu 14.04, 16.04, 16.10. That way we can give the version as well. So Docker runs in two modes. One is the attach mode, other is the detach. Something like when I say Docker run Ubuntu latest, this will directly attach to the terminal of the Docker container. So once we run this command, we'll be directly inside the container. So if you don't want to run it in a attached mode, so we can run with the hyphen D detached mode, Docker run hyphen D Ubuntu latest. So this will create the container, but it will not attach to the shell. So this will directly attach to shell. So if you execute this command, we'll directly go inside the container. If we run this command, a container will be created and it will be up and running, but we'll still will be inside the machine, and then we need to Docker attach to log into the container. Okay. So this complete. Then if I say Docker hyphen hyphen version, this will give the version of the Docker. Docker help will give a lot of commands. Okay. So Docker let us say images, will give list of images. So we need to start the Docker first. Docker is installed, Docker is started. And what is the state of Docker? Is running active. Okay. So these are all the processes which are running from Docker. Right, we install Docker, then we start the service.
Santosh, is it typical to install like everything in Docker? Because you mentioned yum install Docker with the static. So all Docker, install all the Docker binaries, anything is available?
Anything is relevant, means you want to install only specific things?
Oh, I'm just asking, I don't know. Let's say if we, is it a way to install like everything, whatever is available on the Dockers, like yum install
Docker?
Yeah,
so everything, any utilities available with Docker will install.
Oh.
So anything is missing like Docker Compose or anything, it will install. So everything will be installed with start. Okay. So I'll say Docker pull Ubuntu latest. So this will pull the image from the cloud, which is Ubuntu image. So Docker will image will have some layers. These are called layers. So this is like we take a base image and on top of that we install something, right? So every time when we install something, it will create a new layer. We'll see them later. But basically it will download the image and there will be layers in the image. So now if you see Docker images, we have one image which is downloaded and tag is latest and this is the image ID. Okay. And in Docker club, cloud, this image gets updated. If any new feature is there, they'll be updating the image, right? So this will be from the Ubuntu official. docker.com, search for anything.
So those images are not open source but from the vendor itself, like Ubuntu build those images for Docker?
Yeah, they are open source but they are actually official images from Ubuntu. If you see Ubuntu official.
Okay.
So now let me try to create a container out of the Docker. So Docker run Ubuntu latest. Docker PS. So there is no container running. So by default, when we run the Docker, we need to attach a shell to it, right? So if you don't do anything, if you don't attach anything, it will not run. So let us say Docker run Ubuntu latest bin bash. There is a container created, somehow it is exited. Let me see what I can start it. I think there is a command to start. Yeah, this option we need to use docker run -t -i. Docker run -t -i Ubuntu latest. This will run the container. I is for specifying the image, and then we logged in inside the container. Because this I did not run in the detached mode, so by default it gets attached to the container. Now if you see, earlier I was on CentOS machine, now I logged into container. What is the version? Ubuntu. Ubuntu 16.04 I was able to download within few seconds, right? So the same thing if I do with a VM, it takes a lot of time to boot. It has a kernel, it has a lot of packages, it has a lot of processes, it has a lot of memory. But if it is a container, I could get it within few minutes, right? So this is a Ubuntu. If you see, it doesn't have anything. There are very few limited commands which are required for the OS to run. So these are the packages which are available. Very minimal set of packages, right? So if you see, there won't be anything like NFS. Nothing like LDAP. So only the things whichever is required for the OS to run, the minimum set of directories, files, packages, binaries, libraries will be present. So this is the container. Now we can work with this container. We can create some packages on top of it, and we can create our own image from this container. Let us say I want to ship my application. So I have a base image from Ubuntu. Then on top of that, I can install the packages, dependencies, prerequisites, everything, and I can deploy my application. And once everything is ready, then I can create an image out of this container, right? So right now what I have done is I have pulled the image from cloud. I have created a container. I can customize it. Customization means adding the application, adding the packages, or whatever the file sets required, packages required. Then I can create an image out of it, right? Then this image, I can upload it to cloud, or I can give directly to the customer. So once the customer gets this image and he can create a container out of it, then it's like application will be up and running on the customer environment, right? Is this clear?
So inside the container, all the Linux commands will work, right? It's just like a bin bash, right?
Right. So it's like bin bash. All the commands may not work. Only the basic commands will work.
Okay. So I just did apt get update. Start updating the.
Then you can install whatever the package you need. This is the base image. Okay. So on top of that, we can run. If you want to install something, we can install.
I think it looks like to me is like the container is like a it's like a small version of OS, right? Kind of a thing.
Right. Yeah, it's a kind of OS with limited functionality, limited packages.
Yeah, it looks like they strip away all too many things and they make it very small footprint, right?
Very specific to the environment. If you say Python, we only get the Python file sets and the required binaries which are required for a Python program to execute.
Okay, so I just ran apt get update. It started updating the container.
Right, so yeah, that's how we create a binary out of a container. Then apt-get update, then on top of that, we can install whatever you want. Okay, so then we can also run in detach mode, -d, -t, -i, Ubuntu latest. So this will run in detach mode. So we'll not directly get attached to the terminal, but we have to connect to the terminal to log into the container. Okay, so apt-get update is done. Now I can install any package. Let us say net tools. Now we've config works. So we, by default, it gets IPs from 172.17.0.1.2 like that. We'll see what is this. So internally, there is a networking concept. From how it communicates from the base machine to the containers, there is a network bridge created between the base to the containers, and it communicates using that bridge. Okay. So if I exit from the container, it'll be inside my Linux machine, which is CentOS. And if I say Docker PS, the container is not running. It is not showing any container. So in attach mode, if we run the container and if we come out of the container will by default will be stopped. Okay, if you come out of the container, it will be stopped. There is a way to come out of the container without stopping it. But by default, if you just give exit, it will exit from the container and the container will be in stopped mode. Container PS-A will show the stopped container. So by default, container will assign, Docker will assign some names to the containers, something like this, some random names. These are the names. This is the container ID. Image will have an ID, container will have an ID, unique ID. Okay, let us run in detach mode, -d -t -i ubuntu latest. So this will create a new container in detach mode. Is that flag provided but not defined?
Can we SSH to container from outside? Like we have the IP, like is it bridge tied to the OS, like the base OS only, or it can be accessible from outside if the container is...
I'll come to that. How do we access container from outside? There is something called port forwarding. Okay. Okay. We can do SSH, but we don't have to do SSH because see, nobody will use this Ubuntu container. This is just for example. We create image on top of that and we run the application. Let us say application is running. So how do we access the application? Using a port. So that port from the base machine to this machine, we can do a port forwarding. And use, if we give that port and the IP address of the host machine to anybody, they across the world, they can access this container. I mean, they can access the application running on this container.
Okay, so you have to open a port kind of a thing to put that in.
-d detach. Some options.
I think just try only D, dash D only. Maybe we don't need like T and I. Okay. I D only, maybe.
Okay, Docker run, right? I'm missing run. Docker run -d -t. -d and then -name. So we can also name the container with -name. Let us say I'll give container XYZ, then I give the image name. Docker run -d. So there is a container created with this ID, but we haven't logged into the container. Now if I say Docker PS, okay, the container is, I think, stopped. Container exposure is already present, okay. So there is a container created, but somehow it is getting killed. Container XYZ, container XYZ1. B. Okay, hyphen T, it attaches a terminal, so that's why it will be up and running. So now there is a container created in the detach mode. So the container ID is this. So this is the, it will give first few letters from the entire ID. This is the entire ID, and this is the short version of the container ID. Now there is a container is created in detach mode, but I'm still in server. Now if I want to log into the container, I can do Docker attach and the ID. We should directly get attached to the container and we should be able to log in if everything is fine. Okay, I think there's some problem with the image. Let us download something else. Docker pull Python latest. So there is no image. Let me find.
So Docker attach is basically to get into the container, right?
It's log into the container.
Okay, the same way we did previously, Docker ENI with the name, right? We were in the container.
Right. I think there is some problem with the net or what? It is. CentOS, if you go through this, Nginx, is it problem with Minet or? Some problem with the Docker Cloud. Okay, we'll see this tomorrow. How to attach, detach, start, stop, and then log into the other containers. Okay, so we'll stop here. We'll continue tomorrow, same time. Thank you.